Chapter 11 of The Steam Man of the Prairies by Edward S. Ellis. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. The Steam Man of the Prairies. Chapter 11. The Steam Man on a Buffalo Hunt. With a wild snort of alarm, the three buffaloes turned tail and dashed over the prairie, with the shrieking steam man in pursuit. The boy had taken the precaution to bring a rifle with him. When he saw them flee in this terrified manner, the thought came to him at once that he would shoot one of them and take a portion back to his friends for their supper. It would to a grand exploit for him, and he would be prouder of its performance than he was of the construction of the wonderful steam man. The lumbering, rolling gait of the buffaloes was not a very rapid one, and the boy found himself speedily overhauling them without difficulty. They did not know enough to separate, but kept close together, sometimes crowding and striking against each other in their furious efforts to escape. But after the chase had continued some time, one of the animals began to fall in the rear, and Johnny directed his attention toward him, as he would be the most easy to secure. This fellow was a huge bull that was slightly lame, which accounted for his tardiness of gait. Frightened as he was, it was not that blind terror which had seized the Indians when they discovered the steam man so close at their heels. The bull was one of those creatures that, if closely pressed, would turn and charge the monster. He was not one to continue a fruitless flight, no matter who or what was his pursuer. The boy was not aware of this sturdy trait in the animal, nor did he dream of anything like resistance. So he steadily drew toward him, until within 20 yards, when he let go of his controlling rod and picked up the rifle beside him. A bullet from this, he supposed, would kill any animal, however large, no matter at what portion of his body he aimed. So, raising partly to his feet, and steadying himself as well as he could, he aimed for the lumping haunch of the animal. The ball buried itself in his flank, and so retarded his speed that the next moment the boy found himself beside him. The instant this took place, the bull lowered his head, and without further warning charged full at the steam man. The boy saw the danger, but too late to stave it off. His immense head struck the rear of the monster with such momentum that he was lifted fully a foot from the ground, the concussion sounding like the crack of a pistol. Fortunately, the shock did not materially injure the machine, although the frightened boy expected to be capsized and killed by the infuriated buffalo. The latter, when he had made his plunge, instantly drew back for another, which was sure to be fatal if made as fairly as the first. The boy retained his presence of mind enough to let on full steam, and the concern shot away at an extraordinary rate, bounding over the ground so furiously that the billets of wood were thrown and scattered in every direction, so that now, from being the pursuer, he had speedily become the pursued. The tables were turned with a vengeance. It was only by providential good fortune that young Brainerd escaped instant destruction. The wonder was that the steam man was not so injured as to be unable to travel, in which case the maddened bull would have left little of him. As it was, the experience of the boy was such as he could never forget. When he turned his affrighted glance behind, he saw the enraged animal plunging furiously after him, his head lowered, his tongue out, his eyes glaring, and his whole appearance that of the most brutal ferocity. Had the bull come in collision with the horse or man while in that mood, he would have made short work of him. But great as was his speed, it could not equal that of the wonderful steam man, who took such tremendous strides that a few minutes sufficed to carry him beyond all danger. Johnny quietly slacked off steam, but he kept up a good swinging gait, not caring to renew his close acquaintance with his wounded enemy. The latter speedily discovered he was losing ground, and finally gave up the pursuit and trotted off at a leisurely rate to join his companions, apparently none the worse for the slight wound he had received. As soon as the boy found himself beyond the reach of the animal's fury, he halted the man and made a minute examination of the machinery. The head and horns of the buffalo had dented the iron skin of the steam man, but the blow being distributed over a large area inflicted no other damage, if indeed this could be called damage of itself. The boy was greatly pleased, not only at his escape, but at the admirable manner in which his invention had borne the shock of collision. It gave him a confidence in it which hitherto he had not felt. Turning his face more toward the mountains, he again let on a good head of steam and rattled over the prairie at a stirring rate. An hour was sufficient to bring him to the base where he halted. He had not forgotten the warning of the trapper, but, like almost any inexperienced person, he could not see any cause for alarm. He scanned every part of the prairie and mountain that was in his field of vision, but could detect nothing alarming. He supposed the parting admonition of Baldy was merely a general warning, such as a cautious person gives to one whom he has reason to fear is somewhat careless in his conduct. It therefore required little self-argument upon his part, after putting his man in proper condition, to start off on a ramble up the mountainside. It was not his intention to remain more than an hour or so, unless he came across some game. He had a goodly quantity of ammunition, and was careful that his rifle was loaded, so as not to be taken unawares by any emergency. Although Johnny Brainerd was afflicted with misshapen form, yet he was very quick and active upon his feet, and bounded along over the rocks and across the chasms like a deer, with such a buoyancy of spirits that he forgot danger. However, he had gone but a short distance when he was startled by a low, fierce growl, and turning his head, saw to his horror that he had nearly run against a colossal animal, which he at once recognized as the dreaded grizzly bear. Such a meeting would have startled an experienced hunter, and it was therefore with no steady nerve that he hastily brought his piece to his shoulder and fired. The shot struck the bear in the body, doing just what his shot at the buffalo had done some time before. It thoroughly angered him, without inflicting anything like a serious wound. With a growl of fury, the brute made straight for him. What would the boy have given as he sped down the mountainside, were he now in his wagon, whirled over the prairie at a rate which would enable him to laugh to scorn any such speed as that of the brute? At first he had hopes of reaching his refuge, but he was not long in seeing that it was impossible, and found that if he escaped he must find some refuge very speedily. When he suddenly found himself beneath a goodly-sized tree, it looked like a providential indication to him, and throwing his gun to the ground he ascended the tree in the shortest time that he had ever made. He was none too soon as it was, for the bear was so close beneath him that he felt the brush of its claws along his feet as he nervously jerked them beyond its reach. Hastily scrambling to the very top of the tree, he secured himself among the limbs, and then glanced down to see what his enemy was doing. Great was his relief to find him sitting on his haunches, contenting himself with merely casting wistful glances upward. The sensation of even temporary safety was a relief, but when a full hour had dragged by, with scarcely a single change of position upon the part of the brute, Johnny began to ask himself what was to be the end of all this. It looked as though the grizzly had resolved in making his dinner upon the youngster who had dared to fire a shot at him. The patience of an animal is proverbially greater than that of a human being, and that of the bear certainly exceeded to a great degree that of his expected prey, who crouched in the limbs above. End of chapter 11.